Ladies and gentlemen, whatever we may have thought of David Koresh and the Branch Davidians, and I certainly don't agree with any of their theology, but nevertheless, in a free society, people have a right to express differing points of view and differing lifestyles. And if we bring down the FBI, the Delta Force, and the power of the government and burn out people we disagree with, or if we assassinate them as we did Randy Weaver's wife on Ruby Ridge, then we are in danger of losing our freedoms. And that's why this is a very important matter, and somebody should pay the price for this kind of thing. This was premeditated murder of innocent women and children by government forces in this particular thing. At least that seems to be the charges being levied. Of course, they're saying really the Davidians set themselves on fire, so it was mass suicide. But from what we're beginning to see, there wasn't as much suicide as it was a clear attempt by the government to rid our nation of this troublesome group. And that, to me, is very dangerous precedent.
Mathers says he heard no such conversations, but he does say the Davidians had a large number of kerosene cans collected in a central location to light their lamps. On April 19th, they were worried one of the tanks ramming the building might smash into these cans.
We figured it would end up running over those and rupturing them. And somebody said, we better get the fuel.
The question is, can we believe the government's assurances that it fired no flammable canisters into the main structure where Sherry Doyle died? The FBI long insisted it used no flammable pyrotechnics. Now it's had to admit it did. FBI agents said they had no video or audio tapes concerning those pyrotechnics. Now that's been disproved. The Justice Department says it knew nothing of these flammable canisters. Now it turns out the FBI told Justice about those pyrotechnics back in 1993. The FBI insists it never fired one bullet at the Davidians. Now the Texas Rangers are revealing they have dozens of spent cartridges from a house FBI snipers used during the siege. The government's long denied the U.S. military illegally took part in the final fight. But a former CIA agent is telling congressional investigators Delta troops revealed to him that 10 of them attacked the Davidians that day. A military source says he was told Delta was ordered to, quote, take down the Branch Davidians. Confidence in the Justice Department is so shaken by all of these revelations, senators from Republican Trent Lott to Democrat Robert Torricelli are calling for Janet Reno to resign. Asa Hutchison is one of the congressmen likely to investigate the possibility of a massive cover-up.
For 6 years, we've had the wrong information coming out. Information that should have been available, it was available, and was not disclosed.
A tree's been planted for each person that died here April 19, 1993. Federal agents have insisted ever since then. The truth is, they're not to blame for any of those deaths. But with long-hidden facts just coming out now, new doubts have been cast on just what the truth is. But with long-hidden facts just coming out now, new doubts have been cast on just what the truth is. Paul Strand reporting from Mount Carmel near Waco, Texas.
Pat, this is going to erode confidence in the federal government even further.
Well, I think if there's any confidence left in the Justice Department, I don't know where it is. And I join that chorus that says Janet Reno should step down. She should have resigned some time ago. She has steadfastly refused to do her job. And there are just massive cover-ups. This is only one of many that we have seen with the Justice Department. And it's a shame that the highest law enforcement agency in the United States government has been so tarnished by this record. Well, joining us now by satellite is Michael McNulty. He's the investigative researcher for the soon-to-be-released documentary, Waco, A New Revelation. His previous documentary, Waco, Rules of Engagement, was nominated for an Academy Award. Mr. McNulty comes to us from Fort Collins, Colorado. And Mark, before we start off, I understand that your mother is in surgery and needs prayer, and so we would ask our people to pray for her as well at this time.
I would appreciate it, Pat, very much. Thank you.
You have a clip, or we have a clip from your documentary that says people firing into the Branch Davidian compound. Are you sure that the shapes there are actually human beings firing rifles?
Well, Pat, we've looked at this very carefully. The whole team at MGA Films, and that would include people like Dr. Edward Allard and a number of other FLIR experts. And the evidence is very compelling that the shapes that we're seeing there are indeed human beings. You have to remember, the vehicle that they're coming out of was a Desert Storm vehicle that had been air conditioned. And the FLIR tape itself measures temperatures. And the individuals coming out of that vehicle came out of an air-conditioned environment into a much warmer environment. So in the concept of FLIR, they would show up as dark, oblong objects. Now, in FLIR, you're not going to be able to see details of faces and noses and the like, but you will see the general shapes, and you do in this footage. Now, as those bodies warm up and gain the temperature of the surrounding soil, an amazing thing happens. They disappear. Because as far as the thermal imaging equipment is concerned, they are the same temperature, which is what it's measuring, as the soil around them and the rubble and debris. However, when their guns fire, the muzzle flashes are very distinctive, as you can see in that footage. Mm-hmm. And those muzzle flashes repeat cyclically, as an automatic weapon would fire, as a matter of fact. They fire, or they appear on the image, at the same rate as does the rate of a gunfire of about 600 rounds per minute.
Let me ask you about this canister. I understand there was a 40 millimeter canister that was fired into that building. Where did it go? I should say into the building. It was fired, but where did it go and what was the effect of it?
Well, actually there were several. The first two that we're aware of are U.S. military CS gas rounds, and they're pyrotechnic in nature. Now, these two rounds, we have never claimed and don't claim now that they were involved in the fire setting. They, in fact, landed on the roof of a structure about 30 yards away from the main compound or the main structure, and this roof was made of plywood covered in tar. The fact is that my colleagues and I at MGA Films have looked at this, and you know, we've come to the conclusion this is sort of a red herring being offered by the government. The fact remains that it is significant in as much as these two projectiles, they're XM651E1s, which is the classification of CS pyrotechnic round used by the military, were indeed fired. There is videotape of them being fired, and the effects of them being fired, giving off a cloud of white smoke, is clearly visible in the videotape. This is also included in the film Waco, A New Revelation. I think the key here is all the significance that is attached to those two projectiles is the fact that it verifies that the government has lied for 6 years about the existence of the use of pyrotechnic rounds. Now, there are some other rounds that were used. We're in the process of conducting an examination of these rounds. Dr. Frederick Whitehurst leads our investigative team, and he is a very well-known scientist in the areas of explosive residue and residues that would be associated with these projectiles, so that we can determine by back engineering exactly what the function of these projectiles were. Now, these two projectiles were also found in the evidence locker by myself and my colleagues in our last visit, our first visit to the Austin evidence locker. We found these projectiles and took residue samples under the supervision of the Texas Rangers. And those samples, again, are being tested, so we're not quite prepared to tell you exactly what they were. There are indications in the evidence, and some compelling evidence, I might add, that indicates that these projectiles passed through the building. They had a submunition inside of these projectiles. The projectiles themselves were designed to penetrate doors, walls, and windows. And they appear to have done just that and expelled their submunition on the interior of the building.
One last question. It is against the law of the United States for military forces to be involved in a situation like this without certain safeguards being carried out. We understand that there's some FBI surveillance footage that indicates that Delta Force troops were actually shooting. They shot a number of rounds into the compound. Could you expand on that?
Well, sir, the fact is that there's footage that was taken by the Department of Public Safety as well as the FBI. That and some still photos and a number of documents that will appear in our new film that basically have been confirmed by virtue of eyewitnesses who have looked at this material and confirmed that indeed these individuals that are seen in this footage are members of the vaunted Delta Force. Now, when you and I raise that name, the government rolls its eyes and said, well, there's no such thing as Delta Force. Well, in effect, they're true. That's a popularized fictional name that sort of a moniker that's been picked up in Hollywood, so to speak, in films, etc. The proper name for this organization is the Combat Applications Group of Fort Bragg, North Carolina. And indeed, we have gotten confirmations, multiple sources, several of which appear in the film, the new film, Waco, A New Revelation, as confirming that indeed these individuals are members of Delta Force. They're fully armed. And in the infrared video, we suspect that indeed and have been told that the individuals firing the weapons in the infrared video are a mixed group of hostage rescue team members and Delta Force.
And our time is unfortunately running out, but who is in position in the United States government to order a Delta Force team into operation? Where would that order have to come from?
Well, sir, I'm afraid we have another one of those Lewinsky types of mysteries here. The fact is the President of the United States is the only authority who can issue an order to Delta Force to take action as they appear to have at Waco. Exactly what's going on here, we're not sure yet because, of course, Mr. Clinton has denied that he signed a waiver for the presence of these forces. But there are indications, some of which are shown in the new film, that in fact they did have a waiver and they were there with presidential authority.
Michael McNulty, thank you very much for the work you're doing. We appreciate so much your being with us.
Thank you, sir, for the opportunity.
Ladies and gentlemen, the problem we've got here is one more example of this particular administration scoffing at the law, lying to the American people, covering up, and then some terrible thing takes place. This is not the province of crazies. Michael McNulty has already gotten an Oscar for one of his films, and it's a very careful documentary, but this is one of many evidence, pieces of evidence that is coming to light on this tragic situation. You say, well, why couldn't we do this? Well, ladies and gentlemen, whatever we may have thought of David Koresh and the Branch Davidians, and I certainly don't agree with any of their theology, but nevertheless, in a free society, people have a right to express differing points of view and differing lifestyles. And if we bring down the FBI, the Delta Force, and the power of the government and burn out people we disagree with, or if we assassinate them as we did Randy Weaver's wife on Ruby Ridge, then we are in danger of losing our freedoms. And that's why this is a very important matter, and somebody should pay the price for this kind of thing. This was premeditated murder of innocent women and children by government forces in this particular thing. At least that seems to be the charges being levied. Of course, they're saying really the Davidians set themselves on fire, so it was mass suicide. But from what we're beginning to see, there wasn't as much suicide as it was a clear attempt by the government to rid our nation of this troublesome group. And that, to me, is very dangerous precedent.